This tutorial shows you how to conduct a multiple linear regression in SPSS and interpret the results. This video is not testing any of the assumptions needed for a linear regression. Please refer to the videos linked in the description for that. In order to calculate a multiple linear regression in SPSS, go through Analyze, Regression, Linear. A dialog box will appear which will enable us to specify the regression model. The dependent variable goes into the box with the corresponding name. In my example, it is the income variable. Next, we will put all independent variables into the corresponding box as well. I chose only ordinal and scale variables on purpose for now to make the interpretation easier. You can and should, of course, use more than two predictors. Use as many as necessary and as few as possible. Theoretically, you can then go ahead and let SPSS calculate the model. If you need confidence intervals, you can request them under statistics. You will also find the descriptives here and the R-squared change, in case you decided to not enter all predictors at once. Because I often get the question, one note on entering predictors. If you have a sound theoretical foundation for your model, you will calculate the model with all predictors entered at once. An accepted alternative would be hierarchical or blockwise entering, with the first block consisting of the control variables or covariates, and the second block consisting of all hypothesized predictors. Using stepwise, remove, backward and forward entering is only feasible in an exploratory setting, since the model building is based on mathematical thresholds only. If you must choose one of them, backwards runs the lowest risk of committing type 2 errors. See the source in the video description for further information. Let's now focus on the regression output. In its basic form, we have four tables. The first one simply indicates what the model consists of. It shows the dependent variable and the independent variables that have been entered into the model. The second table is the model summary table. It is common practice to look at the third table, called ANOVA, before the model summary, however. The ANOVA table shows the F-test. The F-test shows you whether your model is better than no model. No model means that only the average value for the dependent variable is used, which in most cases obviously is not a good model. The null hypothesis of the F-test states that your model with the independent variables is not better than no model. In my case, this would translate into the following null hypothesis. Using IQ, motivation, and GPA to predict income is not better than not using those predictors at all. In order to test the null hypothesis, the p-value, aka significance, is used. It is compared to a usually predetermined alpha level. 0.05 and 0.01 are often found. Use common sense though, because p-values are only functions of sample size when effects different from 0 exist. In my case, p is smaller than 0.001, and the null hypothesis can clearly be rejected. This means that my model with IQ, motivation and GPA is better than no model in explaining income. Since we now know this, we can shift our focus to the model summary to get an idea of how well the model fits the data. We have a couple of numbers here, but the main focus should be on R squared, also known as the coefficient of determination. The R squared is the amount of variance of the dependent variable explained by the model. It normally ranges from 0 to 1. In my example, the R squared is 0.412. An R squared of 0.412 means that 41.2% of the variance of the income variable is explained by my model, meaning the IQ, GPA, and motivation. If your R squared is lower, there is no need to panic. This is a constructed and not a real-world example. The R squared measure is used to compare your model with other models in regard to fit. Obviously, the higher the R squared, the better your model can explain the variance of your dependent variable. It goes without saying that a linear regression model using only a few variables tends to explain less variance of the dependent variable when compared with models with a higher number of independent variables. For instance, you can further add gender, working hours, industry, academic background, and so forth as predictors and will gain more insight into income explanation. However, R squared will also be inflated when adding more predictors to the model. For this reason, we have an adjusted R squared given right next to the R squared. The adjusted R squared hints that some of the predictors inflate R squared, which we will now check in the fourth and final table, called coefficients. At first, you will ignore the line that says constant. Simply focus on the lines with your predictors, in my case IQ, motivation and GPA. Check your significance first. It is shown in the last column and for my example, IQ has a p-value of 0.002, GPA has a p-value of 0.819 and motivation of 0.905. Please note that the p-value shown here is always for two-sided hypothesis testing. If you have a one-sided, aka directional hypothesis, which has to be declared before doing the actual testing, you can divide the p-value by 2, if the direction of the coefficient is correct. The null hypothesis for coefficients is always that there is no effect or influence of the independent variable on the dependent variable. If your p-value is small enough, this null hypothesis can be rejected, hinting that there is little chance of random influence. In other words, for IQ, the p-value associated with a B's t-statistic is the probability of getting a t at least as big as the one we have if the population value of B was 0, i.e. if there was no relationship between that predictor and the outcome. T is used to calculate p. The larger t, the smaller p. The predictors that show no low enough p-values cannot be interpreted any further, as the amount of chance for an influence expressed in said p-value is too high. Next, we will look at the unstandardized B for IQ, which is positive in my example. This hints that an increase in this variable leads to an increase in the dependent variable. For my example, this means increasing the IQ leads to an increase in income. More precisely, a 1-unit increase in the independent variable leads to an increase in the dependent variable by the unstandardized coefficient. For my example, an increase in IQ by 1 unit increases the income by 41.9 units. This way of interpretation works only for ordinal or scale variables though. If you have categorical variables, you will need to code dummy variables first and then interpret the results differently. See the linked videos on how to do that. By the way, if you divide the unstandardized B by the standard error, you will always get the t value, which, as I've already mentioned, is used to calculate the p value using the t distribution. A quick note on the standard error. It measures the accuracy of the regression coefficients, representing the average distance that the observed values fall from the regression line. What if you had more than one significant predictor? You would interpret them in the same way if they were on an ordinal or metric scale. As mentioned before, categorical variables are a different story and are the main topic of a different video in the description. If the question comes up, which metric or ordinal predictor had the strongest influence on your dependent variable, the unstandardized coefficient is not helpful, as the value range plays a role here. To get rid of the value range, you would turn your attention towards the standardized coefficients, called beta, in SPSS, when the p-values are sufficiently low, of course. I will ignore the p-values for this example to illustrate how standardized coefficients work. You will evaluate the absolute standardized coefficients. The standardized coefficients are the following: IQ 0.718, GPA 0.067 and motivation 0.027. It is pretty obvious here that IQ has a 10-fold magnitude compared to GPA and 25-fold magnitude compared to motivation. If you were able to influence a predictor, base your decision on the standardized coefficients. Reminder, I assumed low enough p-values for all predictors to illustrate how standardized coefficients work. My example has only one significant predictor, making the interpretation of standardized coefficients obsolete though. Finally, a quick word regarding the constant. The constant is the value of the dependent variable if all predictors are zero. The constant is typically not interpreted and is only relevant for making predictions based on the model's results, which is shown in the following video.